Please join with me in our responsive call of worship. Arise, shine, for your light has come.
We are called out of our darkness into light.
Look up your eyes and look around.
We rejoice in the gift of light.
Come, let us worship the God of light and joy and peace.
We come to kneel and cradle and lay the light in our hand.
Let us worship together. Let us join together in our opening hymn, Once in Royal David City. We received a letter from Project Share thanking us for our donations. They were able this Christmas season to help 382 individuals and 89 families. And so we celebrate with them the great success that they had in meeting the needs of many in our community. Do we have any announcements for congregation this morning? As we come to our time of prayer this morning, let us remember everyone listed there. We would add Martha Ryan's niece to that, Rhonda Hillcruder. She is having some very serious heart trouble. Let's also keep Martha in our thoughts and prayers as well. She's not feeling well. We're going through a great change in our nation, so let's pray for our leaders. Let's pray that they will use the gifts that they have and have been given to lead this nation through this turmoil and do something very positive. One of my favorite scripture lessons is the one that I'll be using this morning. It just talks to me about how God has planned for us and given us that which we need. It talks about the salvation. It talks about the gift of Jesus. And it's just one of those beautiful scripture lessons. And so I'm reading out of the Gospel of John, the first chapter, verses 1 through 18. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life. And that life was the light of all people. A light shines in the darkness, but the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify to the light so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everybody, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed on his name, he gave the power to become the children of God, who were born not of blood or the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. And we have seen his glory, the glory of a Father's only Son, full of grace and truth. John testified to him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me ranks ahead of me because he was before me. From his fullness we have received grace upon grace. The law indeed was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. It is God, the only Son, who is close to the Father's heart, who has made him known." May God give his blessing to the reading and understanding of this his holy word. Amen. And now let us join together in our sermon hymn, "What Child Is This?" You have a way that you have called us to go, and we are grateful that you have separated us, that you have made us individuals who come together as one to serve you. We pray for our nation. We pray for our leaders. We pray for stability and peace and hope and opportunity and liberty. We pray for those who are in need today, those who are sick, those who are hospitalized, those who are in nursing homes, those who are facing COVID-19, anyone who might have need today, Lord, we lift them up into your care. May you bless and keep them, may you fill them with your love and send them forth to witness their faith with others. We ask that you would bless this gathering with your Holy Spirit. Touch the lives of those who are here, those who are listening. Walk with each of us this week and give us opportunities to share our faith with others. For it is only as we share that faith and bring others into your kingdom that we fulfill your calling to go and make disciples of all nations. Be with us now, Lord, as we pray, for we pray in the name and in what? And the prayer which Jesus taught us, "Our Father, who art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. It is the first Sunday of the new year, and from what I understand, and many people are happy 2020 is over, but it is always good to look forward to the coming year. Bill called his parents, wished them a happy new year, and his dad answered the phone, and he said, "Dad, what is your new year's resolution for this year?" And his dad said, "To make your mother as happy as I can all year." And when Mom got on the phone, he asked her, he said, "Mom, what's your New Year's resolution this year?" She said, to see that your dad keeps his New Year's resolution. Our topic for today is communication. It's an important topic in the family, in the workplace, even in the church, any time of the year. Have you ever sent a message online, text it, and you wonder, did the people really get it, because you never got an answer back? Well, maybe you emailed a colleague or didn't hear back from them, or maybe talking to your kids is like talking to a brick wall. Real communications does not happen when a message is sent. Real communications happen when a message is sent, and then that message is received in a timely and accurate manner. And I would add to that that really effective communication occurs when someone sends a message, someone receives a message, in a timely manner, an accurate manner, and then acts on that message. When a message results in action, that is effective communication. Georgia Sadler is a nurse in San Diego, California. And she was on a mission to raise awareness of diabetes and breast cancer rates among black women in her community. So she set up seminars in many of the churches all over San Diego, but she couldn't get anyone to come to them. Her message was so important. How could she get her community together to receive them? Sadler, instead of setting up any more seminars, came up with the ingenious idea of training local hairdressers to talk to their clients about diabetes and breast cancer. I guess not verbatim, but what hairdressers are natural communicators. They hold positions of trust in women's lives. So Sandra ditched her informational seminar format and hired a storyteller to train these hairdressers into discussing health issues like diabetes and breast cancer with their clients. Rates of diabetes testing and mammograms rose significantly in the communities where Sadler had trained these hairdressers in her communication technique. When you really care about getting your message across, sometimes you have to get creative about it. Imagine how disappointing it is to send out an important message that never gets through. There's a fascinating, a real-life example of that happening. On Valentine's Day, February 14th, 2019, hundreds of thousands of text messages were sent all over the country and then disappeared. Notice that many of these lost messages were Valentine's. They were never received until almost 9 months later, when those original text messages begin to show up, popping up in the recipient's phones. Imagine the confusion that brought about. Some of those messages were now from people who were deceased, or from lovers who had ended their relationships. And this massive example of miscommunication was finally traced to a company by the name of Cineverse, a company that provides network services for many of the cell phone carriers in the United States. A single server on Cineverse went offline on Valentine's Day, trapping hundreds of thousands of unsent messages in its system. And it wasn't fixed until November of 2019, and suddenly all those unsent messages flooded into people's cell phones, creating all kinds of confusion and possibly some awkward conversations as well. Could you imagine sending out, "I love you, babe," or "so glad I married you," or "I can't wait to celebrate Valentine's Day with you," and not hearing back from that person? How many arguments and hurt feelings do you think that caused by those missed messages? And I think about those late messages when I read our Bible passage for this morning. Because these first few verses of the Gospel of John are meant to be for us a message of love. Even if they start out somewhat confusing. John 1:1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Note that in writing the Word, John is talking about the Word is Jesus himself. Pastor John Piper puts it this way. He says, "Jesus himself is coming and working and teaching and dying and raising was the final and decisive message of God." Did you get that? Jesus himself is the final message of God. God sent us a message. But as we noted about communication, it's only when someone receives that message in a timely and accurate manner. And really effective communication only happens when the recipient receives and acts on that message. So what about us? Do you want to head into this new year with a message from God? Then these verses of John have some exciting things to tell us. Here's the first thing that John tells us. When we look at Jesus, we see God's plan for our lives. From the beginning of time, God had planned for us to be his children. We see that in verse 12 here. "Yet to all who receive him, to those who believe in his name, he gave the power or the right or the opportunity to become children of God." Everyone who receives Jesus as Lord gets adopted into God's family and into his love. Simon Hall was a chef in Knoxville, Tennessee. He says his friends and his family worried about him when he decided to adopt two sons in 2017. As he says, "No one can truly understand why I did what I have done, but I did it on faith, and I did it on intuition." Paul, a single man who had a successful catering company, was taking a big responsibility when he adopted these two brothers from the foster care system. And that responsibility grew even bigger when Paul discovered that his two new sons had four more siblings spread out through other foster homes in East Tennessee. Paul's budget was expenses were already pretty tight, but his heart was full of love, and he was willing to take a chance. And he was willing to give of himself, no matter what he had to do to sacrifice for this family, so that all of these children could be reunited with one another. They were meant to be a family, he said. And he was willing to make the sacrifice. So Hall petitioned the court to adopt all six in that family. And as he says in the end, "I knew that is what I was supposed to do." And I knew that they were supposed to be together. And I knew that they would heal in my home. Notice his heartfelt words. I knew that they would heal in my home. From the beginning of creation, God's plan for us was to adopt us into his home, his family, where we could find healing. It's not something that just happened. It's not something that just came up. It's not something that God said would be nice for 2021. From the beginning of time, God has planned this for you. Why would an eternal God create beings made in his image and breathe his own life-giving breath into them and then just leave them to die? The answer is God did it. God made each of us for eternal life. Before the creation of the world, God also worked to create for us an abundant life. So that's the first thing John's telling us. When we look at Jesus, we see God's plan for us. He planned to bring us into his home. Here's the second thing that John tells us. When we look at Jesus, we see God's love for us. In John 1:14, it reads, "And the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us." Not just, "Oh, I have come to visit you," but "I have come to live with you." Instead of waiting for you to come to me, I'm coming to meet you right where you are. That's always the picture of God, the Hound of Heaven, chasing us throughout life until we give our lives to him or until we totally and utterly reject him. It is a new year. I think most of us start off the new year searching for something. Something new. Something different. Maybe we're searching for closure from this past year. Maybe we're searching for understanding or forgiveness. Some of us are searching for a second chance to get things right. Maybe some of us are listening this morning who don't even know if they believe in God or if God believes in them. You want to believe that God is real, but you don't think you're good enough for him to notice you. In your mind, all that smiley, sincere, Bible-quoting people around you, you think God came for them. But you've got a lot of work to do on yourself, you feel, before you can even think of asking God for his attention. Well, I've got news for you this morning. You are totally and completely wrong if you feel that way. And this Bible passage makes it clear God came to live in your neighborhood. God came looking for you. Janelle Perez is a nurse practitioner in Los Angeles. She could perform her duties in a nice hospital or in a private clinic. Instead, she has spent years working among the homeless population on LA streets. In 2011, she assembled a mobile medical team to provide medical help and care and housing for homeless veterans in Los Angeles. Janelle doesn't wear a nurse's uniform. She wears jeans, a t-shirt, and tennis shoes. She carries medical supplies and a battered backpack. Many of the homeless veterans she's trying to reach suffer from mental illness or addiction or post-traumatic stress disorder. And so Janelle has to work hard in order to gain their trust. If you ever dealt with anyone who lived down the streets, you would understand they don't trust anybody. And it takes a long time to gain their trust. She brings along sandwiches, she sits and listens to their stories. And it may take months of visits and conversations Before a vet will let her even take his blood pressure or give him some medicine. She tells of an encountering a homeless Air Force veteran suffering from schizophrenia. He had lived on the streets for 20 years. Janelle found him a safe place to live, but he still didn't trust her. He refused to use the electricity in his new apartment. He refused to let Janelle treat the schizophrenia with medication. To gain his trust, Janelle sat on the floor of his apartment each week and listened to him tell the stories of his life, what he went through, what happened to him, where he had fallen out between the cracks and never seemed to find help. Week after week, she would just sit there and listen to him talk. Finally, after weeks of doing this, she gained his trust. Today, this veteran's schizophrenia is controlled by medication. He's living independently in his own apartment. He's reconnected with his family. He has a brand new life because of one woman who came to him where he was, never gave up on healing this man. John writes, "The Word became flesh, and he made his dwelling among us." The eternal Creator, God, put on our human flesh with its squishy, itchy, weak, and annoying imperfections, and walked in our shoes. He experienced hunger and thirst, frustration, weakness and loneliness, and an overwhelming pain and loss. And he did it all so that he could show us, so that he could show us that we don't have to go searching for an unknowable God. God came looking for us. And when we see God's love for us, we see God's plan for us. We see his commitment to us. So not something off in the distance. Not something unreal. Not something that is without merit. Close to you as the air you're breathing. And finally, when we look at Jesus, we see God's gift to us. In Jesus, God poured out his grace on us. He flooded the world with grace. What is grace? The word means loving kindness or merciful kindness or undeserved pardon. Verse 14 said, Jesus came to us full of grace and truth. Jesus came to show us the heart and the character of God. And all of those qualities were compressed into those two words, grace and truth. In December of 1772, an Anglican priest was preparing his sermon for the first Sunday of the new year. And for his text, he had chosen 1 Chronicles 17, verses 16 and 17. And in this passage, the prophet Nathan tells King David that God has promised that David's descendants would always serve as the king of Israel. But if you remember David's past, he was a young shepherd boy when he was called. But later, he had many sins, including adultery and murder. But because God had promised that he would sit on the kingdom, and his family would do the same thing, God had no choice but to work with this person. And Nathan the prophet tells King David, again, that God has promised that his family will always have the kings of Israel. And David remembered his past. And you talk about grace, the forgiveness of things you never thought would be forgiven. I think we've all experienced that, you know, God can never forgive me for doing that. And of course, we were wrong, as usual. But I can't even imagine the awe and the humility David felt when he heard God's promises in these verses. And he responded, "Who am I, O Lord God, and what is my family that you have brought me thus far?" And the Anglican priest that was reading this story of David was a man by the name of John Newton. And he could relate to David. Newton had been a violent slave trader. After he gave his life to Christ, it still took him many years to realize that robbing a person of their freedom was one of the most horrible things that could be done to a human being. And once he fully confronted his sins, however, he left the slave trade. And he wrote an influential pamphlet explaining and exposing the suffering of these poor people on these slave ships. This pamphlet was distributed to every member of the British Parliament and helped influence the eventual outlawing of slavery in Great Britain. John Newton could never forget the burden of his sin that was lifted from his shoulders by his Savior, Jesus Christ. So imagine how King David's words sounded in John Newton on that day. "Who am I, Lord God? And what is my family that you have brought me thus far?" And with this repentance and this gratitude fresh in his mind, Newton began writing words to a hymn that he would teach his congregation on that New Year's Sunday. "Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home." Most of us want to start off the new year with clarity. There is one area of your life where I hope you have total and complete clarity. It's in your view of God. This is the one issue that will affect every other area of your life. So it's essential, you see, on the beginning of this new year that we understand who God is and what are God's plans for our lives. God has a plan for you, a plan to adopt you into his family. And have a loving relationship with you. God loves you that much. And God has gifts of loving kindness, of mercy, and of truth for all those who believe and receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. God has sent you a message. I hope you have received. But the real test of effective communication is whether you act on it. Now that you receive God's message, will you choose to submit your life to Jesus as Lord and Savior? Amen. As we come to our time of communion this morning, let us listen to our communion hymn, "Amazing Grace." Be hungry. Listen to me and do what I say, and you will enjoy the best food of all. Listen now, my people, and come to me. Come to me, and you will have life. I am the bread of life. Anyone who comes to me shall not hunger, and anyone who believes in me shall never thirst. This table is open to all who confess Jesus as the Christ and seek to follow Christ's way. Come to this sacred table not because you must, but because you may. Come not because you are fulfilled, but because in your emptiness you stand in need of God's mercy and assurance. Come not to express an opinion, but to pray for a spirit. Come to this table then as you are, my sisters and brothers. Partake and share. It is bread for you and for me that we might again know that God has come to us and share our common lot and invited us to join the people of God's new age. Let us pray and let us pray together. Repeat after me, God of all mercy.
God of all mercy.
We confess before you and each other.
We confess before you and each other.
That we have been unfaithful to you.
That we have been unfaithful to you.
We lack love for our neighbors.
We lack love for our neighbors.
We waste opportunities to do good.
We waste opportunities to do good.
And we look the other way.
And we look the other way.
When you cry out to us in the suffering.
When you cry out to us in the suffering.
Of our brothers and sisters in need.
Of our brothers and sisters in need.
We are sincerely sorry for our sins.
We are sincerely sorry for our sins.
Both those we commit deliberately.
Both those we commit deliberately.
And those we allow to overtake us.
And those we allow to overtake us.
We ask your forgiveness.
We ask your forgiveness.
And pray for strength.
And pray for strength.
That we may follow in your way.
That we may follow in your way.
And love all your people.
And love all your people.
With that perfect love which casts out all fear.
With that perfect love that casts out all fear.
Through Jesus Christ our Redeemer.
Through Jesus Christ our Redeemer.
Amen.
Jesus
looked up and said to the sinner, "Where are your accusers? Has no one condemned you? Neither do I condemn you. Go and do not sin again. Thanks be to God." We remember that night of Jesus' betrayal and desertion, how he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We pray, O Lord, that you will consecrate, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and this fruit of the vine, and bless us that as we receive them at this table, we may offer you our faith and praise. We may be united with Christ and with one another. We may continue faithful in all things. In the strength that Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give you thanks that you have called us to serve you. We do remember that night, Jesus' last night on earth. As he was with his disciples, and he broke the bread, and he gave it to them to eat, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This do as often as you drink it, or eat it, in remembrance of me." And he also said, "This is the cup, which is the New Testament, in my blood, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your presence with us in this meal. We thank you for the gift of Jesus Christ. We thank you for fulfilling your promise to come to us And that one day where you are, we will also be. May you bless each of us as we partake of this glorious supper. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, which was broken for you. Do this in remembrance of him. This cup is the New Testament. The blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. This do in remembrance of him. Take and drink. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. Upon him is the chastisement that made us whole. And by his stripes we are healed. Surely he has borne our sorrows. May this communion of the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, keep you in the faith as a reminder that God has loved you beyond degree and has given you the greatest gift of all. Amen. Now let us close our worship service, joining together in our closing hymn, number 229, the First Noel. The love of God, the fellowship, and communion of the Holy Spirit go with you and remain with you always. Amen.